So if you remember, if you've watched the series of video up to this point, you will remember the video with the iceberg, where some differences are visible, some differences are invisible. And what we're doing in the remainder of this series of videos is go deeper and deeper under the waterline. In particular, we're going to talk about communication style differences and the impact that these differences can have in the workplace, creating issues even when everybody involved has the best intentions at heart. One which many people have experienced without realizing where the difference was coming from and noticing what impact it might have is how much emotion should people display in the workplace. There's personality differences. Some people display more emotions than others. And if you remember the slide with the bell curve, we have a wide range of responses on this one. But here I'm going to look at the average. So let's say that this arrow represents the range of emotions that on average English Canadians display in the workplace. For most Canadians, whether they're French Canadians or English Canadians, it's very obvious that on average, French Canadians display more emotions than English Canadians. If you've never noticed it, just watch a bit of Radio-Canada. Even if you don't understand a word of it, it will be very obvious to you quickly that French Canadians do display, on average, more emotions than English Canadians. French people display even more emotion than Canadians. Than French Canadians on average. People in Latin America display even more emotion on average than French people. And Italians get the gold medal. So one situation that where the many people around the world noticed that difference was when Roberto Benigni won both the Academy Award for Best Actor and the Academy Award for Best Foreign Movie for the movie Life is Beautiful. Where in a few seconds you're going to see a link on your screen to that video, to the video that shows you his reaction when he heard his name being called at the Academy Award ceremony. All right, so if you've seen that video, you've probably noticed that Roberto Benigni was on top of the world. He's displaying a very large amount of positive emotion. The key question becomes, was he happier than an American actor who gets the same award? Well, the answer, in my opinion, is no. If you are an actor and you hear your name as the Academy Award, the winner of the Academy Award Best Actor Award, for Best Actor, then you're probably on top of the world. Because as an actor, I can't think of anything that will top that from a career perspective. But I think we can all agree that Roberto Benigni was displaying way more emotions than, say, Matthew McConaughey, Casey Affleck, or Leonardo DiCaprio, three American actors who got the same award recently. So it is very important in my experience to differentiate between emotions displayed and emotions felt. Roberto Benigni is feeling just as much emotion as Casey Affleck, but he is displaying far more emotions than Casey Affleck. In most Canadian organizations, showing too much positive emotion does not create a lot of problems. Why? Because we don't get that kind of experience very often. If you think of your own company, how often do you have the opportunity to display the kind of emotions that Roberto Benigni was displaying in that video? Usually, not very often, okay? The real problem in most organizations is more on the other side. So, typically in professional situations, it kind of looks like that. Let's say you're a team, Roberto Benigni is part of your team, you have a discussion today about the fact that your project is over budget, behind schedule, and the discussion is, how are we going to break the news to our management that we are over budget, behind schedule? How will Roberto Benigni behave during that meeting? Well, let's say, having worked with a number of people from Italy, what I've found is, in a situation like this, the average Italian will show a large amount of negative emotion. They might raise their voice quite significantly, maybe bang on the table, maybe. I remember one of my Italian coworkers who kind of, it sounded like he was about to cry, okay? So showing a large amount of negative emotion. Let's say Roberto Benigni is using half of his scale at that point. His Canadian coworkers will show, let's say they're using half of their scale. The trouble is, so proportionately it's the same. But in absolute terms, half of the Italian scale is far more than half of the Canadian scale. So how do we manage that situation? Well, what happens, first of all? Well, there's a very good chance that Roberto Benigni will interpret the behavior of his coworkers as they don't care or they don't understand. What will he do to make them care or understand? He will crank up the volume. He will show even more negative emotion. And on the other side, his coworkers will try to calm him down by showing less emotion. Relax, we'll get through this. We've had problems like this before. We'll find a solution. And so at this point, the situation is diverging instead of converging. In the healthcare system, one of the situations where this creates huge issues is related to pain management. So here's a situation where it's very typical where this creates problems. I've worked with a lot of 911 operators, like for example in the city of Edmonton, Calgary and Hamilton. And the situation they describe as where this creates a lot of problems goes like this. A lady is pregnant, okay, and her waters broke out prematurely. So she's only 7 months pregnant, her waters broke. Somebody calls 911. The two people, 911 dispatches two paramedics. These two paramedics are the standard, you know, average English Canadian paramedics. The people on the in the house are Middle Eastern or Latin American. So what happens? The two paramedics arrive at the house of this lady, and first of all, instead of the average four people that they're used to, they find 25 people. They also find people who have a very small personal space relative to their own expectations. The emotional state of the people in the house is frantic by their standards. How do the two paramedics respond? Well, quite often, the way they're going to respond is try to take control of the situation, to tell everybody, consciously or subconsciously, relax, we're here, we're going to take care of the situation. So the way they do that is they will stand as tall as possible, use a tone of voice which is as neutral as they can make it, and tell everybody fundamentally, relax, we're here, we'll take it from there. But the trouble is, what does it look like to the people in the house? Well, to them, it looks like these two people don't care, or they don't understand how bad the situation is. So they will amplify the range of emotions that they're using. And there are times when the two paramedics end up calling 911 to send some police reinforcements. So everybody's trying to do their best, but people have different idea of what best is. On the other side, we have East Asia. The average Canadian has a hard time reading the emotions of the average Chinese, Korean, or Japanese. So, for example, when I worked at Procter & Gamble, one of my managers went to Japan on a five-year expatriate assignment. He used to tell me, you know, a happy Japanese looks just like an unhappy Japanese. Couldn't tell the difference. This, in my experience, has a huge impact on people's careers. Why is that? Well, think of Roberto Benigni showing a large amount of negative emotion when the project is over budget or behind schedule. What will his career look like from this point on? Well, he will be labeled as not leadership material. That's it, he's not going anywhere, okay? Another situation where this creates a lot of issues without people realizing where it's coming from goes like this. Let's say the average Canadian manager needs to delegate a high exposure task, or let's say a presentation, to one of his or her employees. How will the manager handle it? Well, the manager will think of all the people who could take on that task, like who's available, who has the right skills, and so on. Okay? Make a list of these people, then rate these people, and then figure out, oh, well, this is probably the best person. So this is the person at the top of the list. The manager at that point will go for tea or coffee with that person in order to assess one fundamental element. How enthusiastic is this employee at the idea of taking on that task? Well, if the average English Canadian manager has in front of him or her an excited Japanese, Chinese, or Korean, there's a decent chance that the excitement of the employee will not register on the scale of the manager. What happens at this point? Does the manager delegate the task to the employee? The answer is no, because that person is not enthusiastic and therefore will not invest extra effort in making sure it's a good presentation. And since this is a high exposure presentation, I cannot take the chance. The Italian person will not get to do the presentation because that person shows way too much emotion and is likely to mess things up. So the person who will end up getting assigned this presentation is someone who shows the right amount of emotion by the manager's standards. And guess what? In many cases, that person looks just like the manager. So from the outside, it looks like favoritism. If you ask the manager, are you favoring people? The answer you'll get is, where did you get that idea? But the point is that decision, which is made on observable criteria, ends up being skewed by cultural differences. So how do we deal with this? Well, one very important thing is gauge people's interest based on their emotional thermometer, not yours. As you work with people, you know, over time, a wider range of people and more people from a particular culture, you will eventually learn to read the range of the culture and the people, the individuals you're working with. So for example, by working with a lot of Japanese through Procter & Gamble and Xerox, I eventually learned that the way Japanese tell you are completely out to lunch is by raising one eyebrow. It's a very subtle facial expression, but it's there. And if you're paying attention, you will be able to pick it up. So this is what I mean by gauge people's interest based on their emotional thermometer, not yours. Acknowledge people's feelings and show how important the issue is to them. What I mean by this is the following. Let's say you're in this situation interacting with someone who is showing way more emotion than you think is appropriate given the situation. If you try to calm them down, step one, and let's say, and that doesn't work, then step two, what I want to encourage you to do is stay here and feedback in words what you see. You tell them, oh, I see this is very important to you, let's work on it together, or something to that effect. The idea there is by acknowledging in words what you see, you're showing how important the issue is to them. That will help them calm down. Because fundamentally, emotions is communicating the importance of the issue. There are times that will not work. You've done step one, try to calm them down. Step two, you feedback in words. They're still very emotional. At that point, I encourage you to go in the same direction as them. So this is where you need to mirror their emotions. I'm not suggesting you start jumping up and down like Roberto Benigni at that point, but I am suggesting that instead of trying to calm things down, you change your own behavior, your body language, and your tone of voice to make it clear you understand how important this issue is to them. Very important point. And you will hear that point on several slides because it is so important. We constantly talk about giving people the benefit of the doubt. What does that mean concretely? Well, fundamentally what it means is we need to separate impact from intention. The way you feel may not be the way the person meant to make you feel. And that goes the other way around. The way they feel may not be the way you meant to make them feel.